Thank you so much for staying tuned to this frequency for the program Africa Discourse. I am Wilson Omasho. Well, today on Africa Discourse, we want to take a look at post-COVID-19. Yeah, revamping Africa's social, economic, and political strata. Many continents and, of course, many countries. Yeah, we have five continents, yes. Many countries in the world, they are talking about revamping the economy, talking about putting everything into shape, bringing back politics, bringing back anything that makes them tick. And, of course, Africa also is not left behind. They are talking about revamping the economy, reopening the economy. But many pundits globally, they are asking this question: is Africa ripe enough to talk about post-COVID-19? Yeah, it's not just starting in Africa when compared to other parts of the world. But some top personalities in Africa like saying, since the world is beginning to reopen, we just can't be here and wait for the economy to crumble, wait for our social life to crumble, wait for the economy or the politics to crumble. We have to learn how to live with this. Before I introduce my guest, I'd like to give you statistics of what the world is like when you talk about the infectious rate of coronavirus. As of today, we have 5.5 million infected cases, yes, of coronavirus. Yes, 5.5 million. Now, out of that, 347,069 deaths recorded. Now, this is on a global scale. For recovery, 2.3 million. Well, that is somehow cheery and, of course, a cheerful news. Now, when we come down to Africa, we have, as of today, total number of infections. We have 111,812 cases, yeah, for COVID-19. Out of that, we have 3,354 deaths recorded, and of course, 45,001 recoveries. For the active cases, we have 63,457 active cases in Africa as a continent. Why now, own country, Nigeria, as at yesterday night at about 11:59 or thereabouts, or 11:30, I just can't be sure of the time, we have 7,839 infected cases reported. And of course, the number of deaths just then, the hundreds, recovery also 2,000 plus and counting. Now, this is a statistics for the globe, Africa, and of course, Nigeria. Here we are talking about post-COVID-19, revamping Africa's social, economic, and political strata. Are we really ripe to talk about this? Not fully aware that Africa is just starting, according to persons in the world. With me here in the studio to throw more light on this, I have a legal practitioner, a human rights activist. Join me to welcome Barrister Henry Nwozor. Barrister, welcome to Africa Discourse.
Wilson, good afternoon, and viewers and listeners, good afternoon, and God bless us all.
All right. Reverend Humphrey Ariga ought to be here, but due to one or two commitments, he wasn't able to make it. Not to worry, next week you're going to see him here live with me. While God sent Hermose Osaige, just couldn't make it due to other commitments. Now, Barrister, we have these figures, staggering figures before us, 111,812 cases in Africa, above 3,000 deaths, and of course, 5,000 recovery active cases, above 63,000. And here we are talking about post-COVID-19, revamping economy, revamping our social life, and of course, our politics. Are we really ripe for it yet, knowing fully well that the number of infection globally and, of course, in Africa is increasing?
Well, accepted that somehow the number of persons who are infected by the coronavirus is increasing, but we thank God that the rate as it were in Africa is not like what you find in America, UK, and other parts of Europe, because somehow God, in his infinite mercy, has been merciful to us, coupled with the fact that some other factors, either you are looking at our environment or you're looking at our the kind of remedies that we have tried to use to see how we contain it, as it were. But the question is, what happens after the issue of the coronavirus? What will be the position of Africa, as it were, in terms of the global economy? Presently, there is a decline in the GDP. Presently, there is social disruption. We also find that we have the economy is affected because African countries, as it were, none of us were ready for actually what actually came to pass, because the leaders, as it were never prepared for it, even when they were aware, as far back as December, that this is what is happening. But we all kept quiet and quiet, and before you know it, the thing is already ravaging the African continent. But again, you also discover that we have been able to manage it by, you know, applying some certain kind of strategy. Some try to adopt the Western strategy of lockdown, but some here have equally decided not to use lockdown. Some African countries, they have decided to do it their own way. Though in Nigeria here, we have tried lockdown, we have tried partial lockdown, as it were, and it has equally affected the economy. Presently, as we speak, we know most of the companies or most of all those small-scale businesses have been affected. And you find out that in this part of the world, we live virtually from hand to mouth. The kind of business we do is not the business that enables us to sustain. And this has affected the economy, as it were. But I know of a truth that at the end of the COVID-19, as it were, that the economy of Africa will bounce back, because now our leaders will now begin to see the need to look inward. Our leaders will begin to see the need for us to do the right things. Our leaders will now see the need for us to invest in agriculture, invest in other areas where we have a comparative advantage than other parts of the world. If you look at it, today as we speak, Vietnam was in war for 20 years. But when they came out of the war after 20 years of the war, they had over 95 million of them. They were able to remove 45 million of them out of poverty. Today they are into textiles, they are into agriculture, and they are doing very well. Bangladesh, as you see Bangladesh as it is, Bangladesh does not depend on the drugs that they will get from India, which is their next door neighbor. They manufacture 97% of the drugs they use. So nothing stops us from this part of the world from doing that which other parts of the world have done, and they have succeeded in it. We have the roots, as it were. You go into the bush, you have enough leaves. Before now, our parents, our great-grandparents, they were not waiting for the drugs that have been run. They have what they use in treating them. We have our traditional medicine men, as it were. They can go into this, and the government on their own part will assist in ensuring them. Today, China is doing well. It's because China, 70% of the drugs that you find in sub-Saharan Africa are supplied by China and India. And the economy, they make so much. China makes up to 120 billion every year. Both India, 33 billion or more every year from the fact that they supply them. What stops us in Africa from looking inwards, ensuring that which we need to import from all these parts of the world? If you check the history of China, as it were, in 1990, the global, what China does, 3% of what they were able to manufacture. But today, you go into the air conditioner, they have 80% of it. You go into phones, they have over 70% of the produce. You know, shoes are not working, textiles are not working. In steel industry, they are there, within a space of time. So nothing stops us in Africa if our leader, because the challenge we have is our leader trying to do things right when it is necessary, not depending, one wanting to copy what others are doing.
Now, talking about copying, because that's the next question I really want to throw at you. Now, other parts of the world are talking about reopening the economy, and they have a roadmap. They have structure on how to go about it. And like what you said, Africans will like copying. Do you think that if we copy the way these other countries are trying to reopen the economy after COVID-19, do you see us being able to stick to the principle stricto sensu to make our economy revamp, our politics come back to normal, and of course our social life becoming what it used to be, or more than what it used to be?
You see, the truth still remains that there's no way it's going to be possible, because in this part of the world, the system has not been structured in the same way it is in these other parts of the world. Here, we don't have a kind of a policy that ensures that at the end of the day, things are done the way they are supposed to. Take, for example, the issue of face masks, of putting on face masks. People here, certain persons do not see the reason why they should put on face masks. This morning, I was in a bus going somewhere. I was even quarreling with one of the passengers. I said, you need to do this. The police officer was looking. But in other parts of the world, once government makes a policy that these are things that need to be done, people obey. Again, the government has a kind of an arrangement where you look at it as the social life of the people are structured in the form that if, for example, at the end of the day, the people do not have what to take. Like they are saying lockdown. In some parts of the world, when there is a lockdown, people, palliatives are given. What happens in these parts of the world? Those things that I even brought, you find out that it is the same politicians that go and carry all these things. They are never distributed. In the locality where I live, I didn't see anybody give anything to the poorest of the poor. I'm not talking about myself. For the poorest of the poor who are supposed to benefit, they have never benefited. So you find out that we try to copy what others do, but we don't do it the way they do this. Because if we do it the way they do this, at the end of the day, the hardship we are talking about, the economy revamping and others will go to work. But you find it that at the end of the day, what you find here is that people will always do things for their own selfish interests. And that is the challenge we have.
People doing things for their own selfish interests, that is a challenge we have, the statement of Barrister Henry Wong. So we're taking a look at post-COVID-19, revamping Africa's social, economic and political strata. Is it possible? Now, people are like saying that since the advent of COVID-19 is like African GDP. Yes, you're right about
it
that. It dipped greatly, immensely, and now Africa is indebted by trillions of dollars. And they are talking about if you take a look at Africa pre-COVID-19, it's like it's not measuring up to the world. And I'm talking about post-COVID-19. How do you think we can really put Africa on the map to make us the cynosure of our eyes, globally speaking?
It is possible. The question is the leaders ready to do this? The leader in Madagascar has to put a lot of pressure on WHO to ensure that the vaccine which the country produced was able to be given an opportunity for it to be clinically tested. Because the people there have decided to do the needful. And their leader is a leader who is ready to ensure that that which they have done becomes meaningful to the society. The question there is, how many leaders are ready to take the bull by the horn, to ensure that the economy of their nation, as it were, notwithstanding what is going on, they're able to revamp it? A lot of things need to be done. They can go into agriculture. Because when you are talking about revamping the economy, as it were, a lot of things that need to be done. That the COVID-19 will come and go. It will never remain there. But what is the plans of the leaders for tomorrow? That is the question we are talking about. So the leaders have to look inwards to ensure that at the moment the COVID is out, what do we do to ensure that our people have a better living? Today, I am happy because the hospitals are getting, the hospitals are being maintained. You will now see government trying to, the equipment they never bought before, now they are buying them. Ventilators and others. If you go, if you take opportunity, go to some of these centers, you see the state of art, what equipment that the government have given. Are you not telling me that before now, the government wouldn't have been able to do it? Money has been voted in times without number. But in the same society we live, certain persons will do a word with the money, have reasons for doing it, and nobody will ask questions. So I know that after the COVID-19, with what the government has done so far in the area of the health sector, it will improve. And government will equally do other things in other areas. Agriculture, the federal government is talking about investing in agriculture. Though this morning I read that the president was saying that there will be no money for them to go into importation of food. But I do not see any reason why we need to go to. What do you do? It's to empower the farmers here. Those farmers, those who are really farming. Don't know those who farm based on paper. Because a lot of persons will collect money that is meant for farmers. They will claim they are farmers. But this money will be shared for them. They will just go back home and they have nothing to show for it. But those who are real farmers should be given money to enable them to go into good farming at this point in time. Because we are in the farming season. There will be a lot for us to eat after this COVID-19.
So right. Government should do that. All right, now if you take a look at the COVID-19 era, very few countries are able to cash in on it. For instance, China, they went into mass production of face masks and, of course, ventilators. U.S. also the premier company to start producing ventilators. But take a look at Africa as a country. Only Senegal was able to manufacture something similar to a ventilator, and it's so cheap, $60 compared to $16,000 when you talk about foreign ventilators. Now take a look at Madagascar. Are able to produce drug, though WHO is still having a knack with that drug. These are the two countries in Africa that were able to cash in, so to speak, from this COVID-19. Do you think that with these two cashing in on what happened during the era of COVID-19, other countries, we have the guts in Africa to trust their products?
Yes. You see, the problem we have is that we tend to believe so much on what we get from the outside world than what we get from ourselves, within ourselves. Even in Nigeria here, in Benin City here, I read when they said some lecturers in the engineering department, University of Benin, they were able to produce a locally made ventilator that uses that does not use electricity, that you can power out for one
hour. But it wasn't mass produced like what happened in Senegal.
Yes, it's because there is no incentive. There is nobody to encourage them. Because if there is somebody to encourage them, money voted for it. And say, okay, gentlemen, you have been able to do this within that space of time. How many pieces can you produce within this? This can be done. And other persons have equally done it in this country who have produced this locally made ventilator. But what you need is encouragement. Nobody will encourage you. That is the challenge you have. Because if the government on its own part encourages the people, makes the people understand that, oh, for everybody, for whatever thing you know you can do to ensure that this period we are passing through, that we'll be able to make a breakthrough. There's no reasonable. I know Nigerians of what we are. We are very creative. We are very innovative persons. I even watched the other day on when they were doing science and technology. Yeah. I saw some certain things manufacture. These are Nigerians. They never traveled overseas to do. They were all locally assembled materials that were used to produce it. So what we need is encouragement from the part of the government. If there's encouragement, this money that they vote in for things that are not needed, money that they vote in for them to go on a visit overseas that they can no longer go now because of the coronavirus. This money should be channeled. Those monies that we have, that government keeps for some other things that for now that are not necessary, there's nothing stopping government from investing into all these our local entrepreneurs who have the wherewithal to produce those ventilators locally. The one in Uniben here, it will not cost anything. Ask them, how much did you use in producing the one you said for 1 hour you can use it without using electricity? It will maybe 5,000 or 10,000. Give them enough money, they can go ahead. And as they mass produce, they try to,
Under whose supervision? Who's supervising? Is it only on the shoulders of the government of the day? What about all these institutions? Can they just start up with something at least? Produce some, let others say that it's working, more than one, not experimental. Then anyone can come in.
You see, the problem with...
Because talking about revamping the economy right now, yeah. COVID-19 seems to be an eye-opener to so many nations of
the
world.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. Yes, I am not saying that the government alone can shoulder the responsibility. That is the truth. Individuals and corporate organizations can invest into them. Recently, Dangote donated
refineries.
One of these equipment which they use for this COVID-19, okay. In Kano and other places. Mm. Our respected Yoni of Ife donated a fumigator which were
locally manufactured.
Locally manufactured. Mm. So what these persons need is not as if we cannot achieve this, because with the COVID-19, the ingenuity in us as Nigerians and as Africans came out. Those of us who have that talent to do certain things that under normal circumstances we wouldn't have done, we're able to do them. Even now with the COVID-19, you will see the face masks you find, you see different designs. All these things are produced by our local tailor. We don't need to go to China to import them again, because we have our local tailor who can sew different, beautiful ones as it were, that you can even use them. Some persons can even sew them with the same cloth they wear at the same time. So you find out that the ingenuity in us can always be common. But what we need is just somebody to assist us, somebody to create that awareness, somebody to give us an enabling environment that whatever thing you do, you will find a place to sell it. But if at the end of the day, those who actually can do these local ventilators, as it were, and at the end of the day, somebody will not want to take it because he will not make money out of it. He will prefer that he's going to a port from China, where we're telling you about import duties, how much he paid for this, how much he paid for that. He bought them for $16,000, than taking that one that is 5,000 naira locally here. But that is the challenge. We have not changed our attitude towards what we produce locally here as a people. Until we have everything and begin to see our own thing, just as China, just as Bangladesh, Vietnam, they all did. Because all these people, they looked inward, they didn't wait. Today, just as I said earlier, Vietnam, after 20 years of war, between 2002 to 2018, there's nothing they don't manufacture.
Within 16 years?
Within 16 years. They have been able to do so well for themselves. In terms of textiles, they're after China, and they are the third in the world. And check China, by 1990, they were only producing 3% globally. But today, up to 80%, virtually, for make conditioner, from phone, shoes, steel. They are leading in terms of steel in all over the world.
All right. Now, according to report, Nigeria's economy was the digit increased by 1.8%. You're talking about the GDP for the first quarter. If this can happen in our economy in Nigeria, do you see it replicating itself in other countries in Africa, or to be bigger than that in some countries that are inclined economically?
Yes. The rise, a lot of factors are responsible. We are no longer importing. As it were, presently, we are not importing anything for now, because of apart from the few medical equipment that were imported before now, but now virtually everything we are sourcing locally. So our economy definitely will grow. Those who travel overseas no longer travel at this point in time. So the avenue for us to go into other places and our money remains here with us. The persons now going, they try to do things locally by ensuring that the small businesses, as we have here, they try to encourage them to do certain things to ensure that at the end, you will see that presently, Nigeria, we are manufacturing some of the, in the Cross River, they are manufacturing the, what is it called? These are the what they use in the hospital. That's in terms of the overalls and
overall, yes.
As well as the masks they use. We are manufacturing them locally. Before now, we import. So all the money that would have been used in importing all these things are no longer there. Some other consumables that usually we import from China and other parts of the world, we manufacture them locally. That is to tell you that it's not as if we don't have the capacity to do all this. We have the capacity to do them. But another question is, by the time all this is happening, you see, go to Abad, they will manufacture a shoe and take it to Dubai and then return it back to Nigeria to sell to the same persons. Or they will sew shirts there and take them to Dubai or take it any other part of the world. And there they will put stickers and return them back to Nigeria and people will buy them. So that is the challenge you have. So if government gives an enabling, encourage Nigerians, make them understand that whatever thing you are able to produce or manufacture locally in this part of the world, our people will take it. Just like the president was singing every day, Nigerian rice, Nigerian rice. Initially, people were saying, oh, there are so much stores and all what. But today, gradually, we are trying to buy into it. So that is what we should do. We should see our own thing and try to do the best we can to ensure that we benefit from it. Because this is a great nation. A great nation with great people. During the Civil War, the Biafrans or the Igbos, they never went anywhere. They never depended on Russia, America, and others for their weapons and all that. Everything was manufactured locally. And they were winning the war until World War came with his idea that everywhere should be locked down, the issue of food should not go. That was how, But they were manufacturing the Winnipegs, their helicopters, and all that they were using fighting. Did they go to anywhere? They didn't. It was locally they were all manufacturing it. So we have the talent, we have the resources, we have the raw materials. Today, Africa, today in the world, this part of Africa produces more than 70% of the raw materials that you find in China and other parts of Asia, which they are using. Because they take them here from here. Because ourselves, we feel that we don't have whether we feel that we don't have the capacity to be industrialized. And I begin to ask ourselves the question, how do you feel that you don't have the capacity to be industrialized at all parts of the world? That is the challenge.
Wow, lots and lots of challenges. We have just barely 3 minutes to call it a wrap on this show. Within that time, I'd like you to just take a dive, just a kind of, you know, a peep into the politics. Like COVID-19 dampened politics in Africa, even globally. Though some countries conducted their elections, for instance, South Korea conducted their own election. Coming down here to Africa, we have Burundi, Mali, and the rest of them conducting election. Now, post COVID-19, do you think that if Africans really want to revamp their politics, so to speak, do you think that they're going to put health into consideration?
Health, definitely. There's no reasonable person who will not put that into consideration. The idea that when you are having a headache, I have to travel to UK or travel to Germany will no longer be there. Mm. Because this is the time for you to look inwards and do the needful.
Yeah.
Because you at this point in time that the crisis is going on, nobody is talking about traveling. Those who are sick, they remain here. Mm. Nobody has said, I'm running to Europe and America. So if you, within this space of time, 3-4 months that we are passing through this coronavirus, as it were, and you have remained here, you have been sick, and you have been able to take care of it, what stop you from doing that, which you are running to in other parts of the world? You can provide them. It does not cost anything. The money you use in empowering other parts of the world can be used in making Africa a better place for all of us. But it's just that our leaders, because of our greed, our self-interest, because when they travel overseas, they are not traveling because of their health alone. Okay. It is an avenue for them to steal money too.
All right, thank you so much. Would have gone further than this, but this is an abridged version. I know you truly understand, but I really appreciate your wonderful analysis. As it stands right now in Africa, we have 111,812 cases. We're talking about coronavirus, and of course, we have 3,354 deaths, cases recorded. For recoveries, 45,001 recoveries. For active cases, 63,457. Globally, it is totally different. Let's see how this war against COVID-19 will be fought and won, because definitely we are tired of almost moribund economy. Everyone needs to really wake up. Anyway, see you tomorrow on International Forum. God willing, bye for now.